To my experience, one of the most effective people that I've met in doing this, not only practicing and teaching it, is Bill Maples. His bio is in the program. We've been so fortunate since Bill becoming a senior vice president at Mission Health in Asheville for him to continue as a clinical professor of medicine on our faculty here and to have him leading much of this activity. He reminds me of Mark Twain's, who said, there are just very, very few people in life who can be very critically constructive and charming at the same time, and Bill Maples is it. Bill, would you come up and say just a few words? Thank you.
Well, thanks, Yank, for the kind words, and it's so great to see so many faces that I've had a chance to walk some of this journey with, and to see so many new faces here, and to welcome some of my colleagues at Mission Health that are going to be a part of the program. So, welcome to everybody. Before I do anything, I think everybody should just reflect for just a second that none of this would be possible without the leadership of Dr. Kobel. He really provided the not only the space, but the physical space, but the emotional and intellectual space for all of us to come together. And it's truly amazing when you think about the work that happens across the community, having practiced here for 25 years. The competition sometimes keeps us apart, but Yank found a way to bring us together. So I think everybody should stand and give Yank a standing ovation for that work. So it's going to be an interesting, provocative day, and I'm delighted to introduce our first keynote speaker, Dr. Michael Leonard. Dr. Leonard is a friend and actually played a part in my transformation in understanding what quality is about and what patient safety is about. There are really no words that I can really summarize his breadth of what he has done for medicine and the understanding that he has provided for so many people as he delivers his message and brings his work and touches the hearts and souls of so many different organizations and clinicians. Dr. Leonard graduated from the University of Missouri School of Medicine and then went on to do his internal medicine and anesthesia training at Harvard's Beth Israel. Then went to Colorado Permanente and had every single title that you can possibly imagine, from staff physician to anesthesiologist, to chief anesthesia, to chair of the board of directors, to whatever. And then followed his heart, which is a message for all of us to really kind of think about, to be certain that we follow our heart and our passions, and really dedicated the rest of his profession career to this topic of patient safety, which is just so critically important. So without any further words, please welcome Dr. Leonard.
So I'm going to talk to you about the importance of kind of culture, leadership, and this, and really how we work in complex systems. And certainly for our friends in the Navy here, you know a lot more about leadership than I learned in the world of medicine. We were basically trained in a very technical fashion, and now we learn that the social side is actually the glue that holds it together. So coming into medicine is this whole concept of socio-technical systems. And what you're seeing here is the cover of the Institute of Medicine report in early December 2012, Better Care, Lower Cost. And there are a couple pieces that come out of this that are critical. Patient-centered care is going to be a front burner, very highly visible process. And the other piece is that 30% of what we spend in healthcare does not create value, waste and harm. And the organizations that are basically capable, facile, of learning, reducing harm, becoming more efficient, being patient-centered, are frankly going to win. But what comes out of this is really a pretty simple concept, that we have an increasingly complex technical environment, whether it's electronic medical records or smart pumps or robotics, and we have people working in these very complex systems. And so you really need to be able to kind of merge or integrate both. So one of the things we learned, I had the privilege in the late 1990s of forming a relationship with Bob Helmreich's group at the University of Texas. And Bob and his group were the people who brought crew resource management into commercial aviation. Because what they found in the late 70s is you could have the smartest, highly skilled people in the world, and you could crash a lot of airplanes. And for a variety of reasons, it was an individual operator model, and it was also a dynamic where often the co-pilot or the junior officer was hesitant to speak up. And in many, many of those fatal events, like our events, somebody knew something was wrong, and they couldn't find their voice, or they couldn't speak in a way to kind of stop this progressive error chain. So one of the things we learn from this world of high reliability is that cultures evolve. And they evolve from being kind of clueless up through reactive, where I frankly think we spend a lot of time delivering care, and where you want to live is proactive or regenerative. So let's think of a simple example. I'm an anesthesiologist, I spend a lot of time in operating rooms, so think about where you've been involved in care. What's a reactive day? You don't know the plan, there's lots of surprises, and you're just working really hard to keep your head above water because you're just rocked back on your heels trying to stay out of trouble, which is a very different dynamic than a team that comes together and says, what are we doing, who do we need, when are we going to need them, what is the plan, we're experts, we can think forward, we can mentally simulate, which is what experts do, and now let's go play offense. And it's an inherently, shall we say, more efficient, safer process, and it's frankly a lot more fun to participate in. And what we're seeing is a slow evolution to saying, we need to come in, get on the same page with some very simple, efficient, formal structures, and we need to basically go forward. And then we need to do quick debriefs at the end to say, what did we do well, what did we learn, what got in the way that needs to be fixed. And again, for those of you in other worlds, this is probably quite basic, but in the world of medicine, this is actually reasonably revolutionary. Because our model has been an expert individual model, and you can go back and read books like Medical Harm by Virginia Sharp that really say, in 1840s, the AMA Code of Ethics said, physicians are gentlemen, the burden of their conscience is so great, no one should sit in judgment on them. That was the codification of trust us, we're doctors, we're smart. And when I trained with some very smart people, the mental model was you can throw a whole bunch of smart people at a problem and they'll just kind of figure it out. Well, the world we live in is far too complex for that to be an effective strategy. And if you think about the inherent failure rate of American healthcare today, 1 in 3 patients, 30% of the people we take care of have something happen to them you and I wouldn't want to happen to us. A glucose less than 50, an INR greater than 9. That translates into 6% of the people we take care of, 1 in 16 staying in the hospital longer or going home with a temporary permanent disability. That is a remarkable rate of harm, despite all these exceptional, skilled, dedicated people. And the Office of Inspector General, who looked at this, said 2/3 of those events are either preventable or, a better term, ameliorable. If you know the glucose is 40 and you're at the bedside fixing it, it's a non-issue. You're putting out a brush fire. If that error chain progresses and the clock continues to run, you have a forest fire on your hand. And we're seeing a lot of interest now in people surveilling for that and being able to intervene in a rapid fashion. So we can essentially apply this model, this kind of socio-technical model, to all the threads that are important for patient care. And what's interesting about this, I'll give this to you, right? I mean, we've developed this. But you can really go into a clinical unit and sit with people and say, with regard to patient and family-centered care, tell me where you are. In about 20 seconds, they'll tell you where they are. You know, down here, it's, well, we got a couple pamphlets and, you know, we kind of have some signs on the wall. But it's really about us. And you can figure it out in 2 minutes if you walk in. Is this care process designed around the needs of the human beings who entrust their well-being and often their lives to us? or is it built for our convenience? And that's very different than being up here, where patient and the voice of the patient, the experience of the patient, is at the center of the process. You want to learn about a care process? Go follow a few patients through your hospital, and you'll see the transitions, you'll see the disconnects. If it's built around them, winner. And then you get up here, which is very rare, but this would be the Dana-Farber. The Dana-Farber, with Jim Conway and company, in the aftermath of a terrible event in 1996, where Betsy Lehman, the health reporter for the Boston Globe, whose husband was and is today an oncologist at Dana-Farber, she received 4 times the appropriate dose of chemotherapy for a clerical error. I was a resident at the Dana-Farber. I could have made that mistake. We were using some very creative approaches to cancer treatment. But what happened over that period of transition? As Jim would describe it, they decided they were going to be completely transparent about the event. They were going to incorporate patients centrally into the process of the institution. They now have over 130 patients on every committee in the hospital, including peer review. And in fact, what the patients said is, first you started to talk at us, and then you started to listen to us, and then you got to the place you worked with us. Tell you a quick anecdote, Dana-Farber. So Jim decides to step down as chief operating officer. They're interviewing to hire his replacement. There's a candidate who's interviewing, does not realize that he's interviewing with a patient. And in the middle of the interview says, "Yeah, I'm not really sure I believe in all this patient-centered stuff." The guy said, "Here's the good news. You can get an earlier flight, dude. This is over. I mean, like, done. Like, goodbye." So it always pays to know the audience. So let's talk about an example of a highly effective patient-centered care process. This is Tony DeGioia's work from UPMC McGee in Pittsburgh. This is an end-to-end solution, orthopedic surgery, high-volume total joint program. The work group includes the parking valet. That's the first person you see when you come to the hospital. And everybody they touch, patients come in a week prior, they see the parking valet, they go to admitting, they go to pre-op, they go to PACU, they go to the floor, they meet the physical therapist. So they have complete predictability. What do you think the cancellation rate is? Somewhere around zero. And he hires pre-med students to follow the patients through the care process. He said, "We learn more from those kids than we learn from anybody else," because they had no preconception of what it was supposed to look like. Every patient comes in, they basically get kind of a guide or a map. So a family member, close personal friend, is their advocate. Here's what you can anticipate during your care process. Here's what it should look like. If it doesn't look like that, please raise your hand. Also realize UPMC was the first organization in this country to have Condition H, where patients and their families can call rapid response teams. And when they call, they're not complaining about the food. They're calling because they're terrified. There's a very, very high fidelity in those signals. So this is seen through the patient's eyes. There's team huddles around every patient, but it's a highly standardized process. A lot of teamwork and safety principles. HCAPs, 91 on a scale of 100. Talk about process measures, about antibiotic administration, stop within 24 hours, over 99%. Look at the average American infection rates. They are 3 times better, right? So it works, it's clinically better. And I'll tell you what's really interesting about this, which I had not known until I actually talked to Dr. DeGioia about this. If you look at total joint replacements across the United States, about 1 in 3 people walks out of the hospital and goes home. 93% of their people or walking without assistance, 91% of those people go back to their life directly from the hospital. And the length of stay is about a day shorter. So what's not to like about this? Now again, it takes work, it takes a team, it takes a very clear, measurable process. Not surprisingly, Tony DeGioia was an engineer before he went to medical school, but this just kind of fires on all cylinders. And these are the people that are gonna win. One of the fundamental challenges we have in American healthcare is linking the complex conversations that occur at senior leadership in a time of great uncertainty and financial pressure with the bedside. And the organizations that do this are highly effective. You know, as Bill said, I lived in many, shall we say, box in the organizational chart in the Kaiser world, and the farther away you get from the bedside, the simpler life seems, or at least the clinical care process does. You wrestle with other, shall we say, complexities. But, you know, you want to be in an organization where there's a systematic dialogue of the senior folks who are seeing a big picture, managing a very, very kind of difficult environment, but linking that to the care of the patient. And I would say, sadly, I've been in a lot of these hospitals where the folks in the suits show up and it's like, who are they? Something bad must have happened, as opposed to these are the people that drive our organization. It's a profound opportunity to share, here are the things we're wrestling with at the C-suite, how does this affect your ability to care for patients? And there's wisdom at the bedside. The people closest to the work always have the greatest knowledge of how to do that work. And we'll talk about a way to capture that. So let's talk a little bit about culture. This is a hospital, and we're asking basically one fundamental question. Of all the people in those care units, doctors, nurses, we can parse it into caregivers, but here we're just looking at the aggregate from the unit. I get adequate, timely information about events that might affect my work from the people who lead my organization. And you can see within the same building that there are places where 8 out of 10 or greater people say, we're in the loop. We know what's going on here. We feel supported. We're aligning it. And then you get down there where that's 3 or 4 out of people. So two things come out. One is, if you measure culture well in a hospital and organization, you'll find a 5 to 6-fold difference within the same building. There's tremendous variation. That's where culture lives. These are very high performing units. These are the places where bad things happen. And I'll give you some examples. We have progressively more data on the relationship of what it feels like to be there, how we talk to each other, how we talk to patients, and the quality of care. For example, we can look at Hansen and Mark Williams' work out of Northwestern a year and a half ago, looking at readmission rates for congestive heart failure and coronary artery disease. For every 10% increase in safety culture, if we go from 60% of people being positive to 70, think about 6 out of 10 people going to 7, you get a relative 10% decrease in readmission rates. It goes from 20% to 18 to 16, et cetera. So the ability to work collaboratively, to have a plan and understand whether we're making good decisions for patients is actually really starting to show up in clinical outcomes. So let's think about a pretty simple model of this. This is Amy Edmondson's work from the Harvard Business School, which I think is extremely valuable work. She's actually one of my heroes. And Amy Edmondson's been talking about psychological safety for 15 years. What does psychological safety mean? You all know it. The people you've trained with, the people you work with, you know the people you're always comfortable going to and saying, I have a question. And why do you do that? You do that because not only are they going to help you, but they're going to treat you with respect. And you can also think of some people you weren't too excited to go talk to. And that's called dangerous, because you've raised the threshold to speak, you've raised the threshold to seek help. I spent 7 years in national risk management for Kaiser Permanente. We have 9 million patients, we have 12,000 physicians. And I can tell you, in virtually every episode of serious avoidable harm or death, somebody knew there was a problem and they couldn't find their voice in an effective manner to get help to the bedside. And the clock ran. And when the clock runs and people are sick and you're not fixing the problem, things get better, they don't get worse. So there's a very simple way to look at this. If you want to have a high-performing organization and an ability to learn, there are really two parameters. One is psychological safety. It is never okay that somebody's concerned about a patient, ever, and hesitant to raise their hand or voice that concern. I can tell you, my group, we have clinical culture data from 1,000 hospitals, 15,000 clinical units in this country, and 20% of people across America tell us they would be hesitant to speak up if they were concerned about a patient. I can also show you some clinical places where half the people in those units said they would be hesitant to raise their hand. And that's just frankly dangerous. That's never okay. This is a primary function of leadership, to set a positive, active tone, to think out loud, to share the plan, and invite people into the conversation. Because effective leaders are what? They're always approachable, right? And these are really fundamental skills that we're just now bringing into healthcare. The other piece is accountability, and we can break this into two pieces. One is professionalism, which is not lacking in the world of healthcare, which is, you know, you get out of bed to make a difference in people's lives, we're serious about it, you know, high ethical standards. And the other piece of this is just culture. How do we make it safe to learn from mistakes? We're making mistakes all the time. We're human beings. We walk out of our house without our car keys. You may enjoy my favorite activity, walking around my house trying to remember what I'm looking for with some frequency, taking some comfort in the fact I can remember I'm looking for something, not time to get in the fishing boat and make that a career. But we're all in the club, right? And put you in a complex environment. I mean, you can look statistically. You and I will make an error of commission. If I give you two drugs that look alike, there's a 1 in 300 chance in a relaxed, rested state, we will give the wrong medication. I'm a pretty well-trained anesthesiologist. I have given the wrong drugs to patients in the operating room. Error of omission. I mean, why do people use checklists? Because there's a 1 in 100 chance you'll forget to check on the patient, turn on a pump, or go look at somebody. And I can give you terrible examples. There was a 70-year-old man who walked into a very good hospital in this country for a total hip replacement. He took one baby aspirin a day. He was a completely healthy individual. He unexpectedly had 8,000 platelets when he walked into that hospital. It was missed by five people: the pre-op nurse, the orthopedic surgeon, the chief resident, the anesthesiologist, the CRNA. In fact, they put a spinal anesthetic in somebody with 8,000 platelets, which is moderately sporting in my world. The lab forgot to call it. They're in the room operating. The guy's in massive DIC when the phone rings. Did you know he had 8,000 platelets? So simple things can make very, very big difference in our world. And this is the place we want to live. So let me show you some cultural data. This is a hospital. And here we're using, this is what's called a scatter plot. We're looking at perceptions of teamwork. We have 100-point scores. Keep it simple. Think about 10 people in a room, right? And safe perceptions of safety. And a simple perception of safety is, you could take care of me. I'd feel comfortable being a patient here. So within the same building, and I will tell you, this is actually a very high-performing hospital. We have some units, like labor and delivery, where almost 100% of people say, we have outstanding teamwork, and we have an absolute commitment to safety. And that's exactly where you want to be a patient. And then when you get down where less than 6 out of 10 people, and I'll show you some of this data, that it's a real tipping point when you get above 60%, you have some inherently high-risk areas down here, cardiopulmonary, surgery, the operating rooms, which are just on the cusp. And I can tell you, you know, if I go into a hospital, I immediately look to see who is knocking the ball out of the park, who's excelling, what can we learn from them, and then I immediately go down where you're inherently high-risk units that don't have good safety culture or have fundamental opportunity, because that's where the risk is. I mean, that's where your risk managers will tell you that in about 5 seconds. So let me show you a little data from a hospital. So this is a good hospital on the West Coast. These are all the units in the hospital. And this is the percentage of people rating teamwork positively within the same building. And you can find some places like obstetrics that are exceptional. 98% of people have positive attitudes, the surgical ICU, the NICU, the ICU. And then we get down to the coronary care unit. 3 out of 10 people rate teamwork positively, right? Good thing they don't have any sick patients. The operating room, 1 in 3, the emergency, you know, the door to the hospital, the ED, where 30% of patients are going to count for 2/3 of the inpatient census. So what's interesting is that we aggregate these and cut it off at 60, and now we start to look at some of the markers. Patients' perceptions of the care process, HCAHPS. In these units, 50 on a scale of 100, 92. Patients and their families process healthcare how? Socially. They didn't go to medical school. They didn't go to nursing school. They're scared. They should be scared. And they're exquisitely sensitive to how do we talk to them, how do we talk to each other, and do they know the plan, right? Have some predictability. Medication errors in these units are 3 times more frequent. C. diff infections, which are very bad things to have, are 3 times more frequent. And stage 3 pressure ulcers are 3 times more frequent. And you know, this comes down to pretty basic stuff. I spent a lot of time working with people in these units. They're very good human beings. And when you get to know them a little bit, what they'll tell you, particularly the nurses, is we have a culture where we don't work on each other. So I'm doing 100 different things in 8 hours. They last about 3 minutes each with continual interruption, distraction. Somebody else is going to turn that patient, right? Somebody else is going to do that dressing change. Somebody else is going to deal with the IV. So it's really the basic blocking and tackling. And when you get up in these units, we're going to turn that patient every hour, 2 hours. We're going to change the IV because we don't want somebody to have MRSA and change their life. So it's really that kind of mutual accountability that says we're high performing, we're going to execute, we're going to do the basics every time. So you clearly don't want burned out nurses taking care of patients because we know we have higher infection rates. And there's a lot of literature on this, and particularly, I mean, you start to look at the literature on burnout, both in nurses and physicians, that's moderately scary. I mean, I've been in institutions where 30% of the ICU nurses were clinically depressed, right, by standard depression scales or pharmacy dispensing. So we're better than that, to be quite frank. So what is the impact on our people? And again, if we use the same cultural data, in these lower performing units or lower safety culture unit, employee satisfaction was 55 versus 91. Look at employee injury. It disappears. It goes from 16 per 1,000 days to 0.1. Absenteeism drops a third. Vacancy rates fall off a cliff. This is the difference between punching the clock and getting out of bed with a passion, right? And again, we don't have a choice. People are entrusting their well-being to us. So can you move the bar? Yes, you can move the bar if you have commitment of leadership and the people who do this. This is St. Peter's Hospital, one of the Providence hospitals in Olympia, Washington, and this is a surgical unit that I had the privilege of working with. Nobody was happy. The doctors, the nurses, the unit secretaries, the patients, it was a mess. And they got together and they said, we're going to make it better. And the surgeons drove it, and they worked with the nurses, and they said, what are the simple ways? We're going to structure care. We're going to talk to each other. We're going to treat each other. We're going to improve care processes. And 100% of the people, we got them in the room. They trained as a multidisciplinary team. We looked at safety culture. They picked explicit things to work on in terms of culture, teamwork, mechanisms, process outcomes, clinical outcomes. This is what it felt like to be there over the course of 12 months. This is pre, this is a year later, that's the hospital average. They went from the lowest performing unit in the hospital to the highest. It can be done. And a big piece of this is leadership. It's nurses and physicians standing together and saying, we're going to do this. We will do this. It's a public commitment to the work. So again, I'm kind of speaking broadly, but let's talk about some very simple leverage points. Effective clinical leadership is essential. Every time you walk in the room, set a positive, active tone, think out loud, share the plan, invite all the other team members into the conversation for their questions, their concerns, use their names. And in fact, we're doing this now in a surgical project because one of the things we discovered in a Kaiser study some years ago was the surgeon's behavior in the first 10 seconds in the operating room had a profound impact on the communication pattern in that room. If somebody walked in the room and said, hey guys, here's what I'm thinking, what are you thinking? All that crosstalk continues. Somebody comes in the room and says, I'm late, get on with it, or how come you can't get a friggin' case start on time? It gets quiet for 15 minutes, and quiet equals dangerous. And in fact, it was published in the American Journal of Surgery. You don't want to be a patient in an environment where it doesn't feel safe to speak. They had poor 30-day clinical outcomes. That's not a big surprise. You're going to stand there and watch bad things happen. Psychological safety is key. Now again, there's this the balance between professionalism and accountability. You got to be smart, know what you're doing, try hard, but you have to create an environment where anybody can raise their hand. I can tell you what, when I go into hospitals, I'm working with a big critical care line right now, I spent 2 days interviewing people. You know, the most wisdom I got was from the housekeepers. The housekeepers are like, they bring all these people up from the ED and these bloody backboards and they throw them in the clean room. They throw all this stuff with C. diff in the wrong place, right? They leave bodily fluids around. I'm like, well, the infection control nurse is about to be your new best friend, right? And you want to go talk to, you want to learn? You go talk to the people nobody has to be nice to, right? You want to know what happens in a unit? Go talk to the unit secretary. They stand there and watch it all day long, right? And they'll tell you what really goes on. And again, it's all about respect. It's all about opportunity. But you can get some amazing insights as to where, you know, to fix things. We have to be able to learn from mistakes, particularly in a culture that trained us, good doctors, good nurses, don't make them, right? As opposed to skilled people working in a complex environment that does, by definition, generates errors. Teamwork, and again, for those of you in other domains like the military, this is inherent. This is not inherent in the civilian side of medicine. It's just we've always been put a bunch of smart people there and they'll figure it out. We're starting to get structured with briefs and critical language and debriefs, which is kind of like duh. And you have to be able to learn and improve. So let's think about clinical leadership. You don't want to be in an environment where it just depends who I'm working with. If I'm working with the right person, good. If I'm not, bad day. And again, ask yourself, when you walk in the morning, how long does it take your brain to say this will be a good day or a bad day? About 10 seconds? In fact, I was working with some emergency medicine nurses. They said, we look to see whose car is in the parking lot when we drive in. And some days we call in sick from the shoe department at Nordstrom's, which apparently has magical powers, certainly has financial magical powers. But it just sets the tone, right? And this is a teachable skill. I mean, I have a clinical appointment at Duke. This is what we teach in the training programs now. To teach the residents, we have to teach the program directors. It's all about effective leadership. So let me show you an example of the converse. So this is a very high volume, high risk surgical unit that will go unnamed. And we went in and worked with them. The culture in this clinical area makes it easy to learn from the errors of others, right? Always easier to learn from somebody else's mistakes. And then you have to segue into, can we learn from my mistakes? So look at the operating room nurses. 18% agree with that statement. Half the surgeons, support staff, like, what are you kidding? Half the anesthesiologists, surgical techs, the anesthesia techs are suspiciously happy, so we'll drug test them immediately, right? Because they're clearly not reality-based here. These guys are doing thoracic surgery. What do you think the chance you're going to raise your hand in that room? Not okay, right? It changed, but it didn't start at a great place. So again, what do effective leaders do? They generate trust. They're open, honest, approachable. They promote respect. Non-negotiable respect is inherent, right? I mean, you cannot have habitual excellence without respect. They create psychological safety, and they make it safe to learn. So let's dig a little deeper into psychological safety. You want an environment where people invite everybody into the conversation. They encourage people to speak up. I'm an anesthesiologist. I am totally impaired when it comes to people's names. So we had whiteboards in our operating rooms. And I'd go in the room, and I'd see the board, and I'd see a nurse that I'd never worked with before. Sue, my name's Michael. I'm glad to meet you. Have you done this before? Are you comfortable? Please, if you have any questions or concerns, do not hesitate to come talk to me. It's an explicit invitation. I've seen patients die in operating rooms because somebody was hesitant to go across the room and talk to somebody because they didn't know how they were going to be received. So it's setting that tone. It's creating that predictability, that familiarity. We're all here trying to do the right thing. You see something I need to know, please raise your hand. One of the best cardiac surgeons I have ever met in my life, Paul Ulig, the nicest guy in the world who's totally into the teamwork. Every time before that knife hits the chest, he turns to everybody in the room and says, I'm fully capable of making a mistake today. Please don't let me. And he has exceptional outcomes. But it's that little bit of humility, it's that explicit invitation. And we basically want to make this just the way we do business. I can tell you today, most of the time, it's like, well, it depends who I'm working with. If it feels right in the room, I'll raise my hand. If it doesn't, plan B. Okay. Safety cannot be personality dependent. It cannot be situationally dependent. What I mean by situationally dependent is at a time of high workload and we're stressed and we're on OB and we're doing a couple C-sections and we got all these people in labor, I would normally surface this concern, but they're busy, so I won't. No. You have to hit the threshold. You have to raise your hand and say, here's what's happening here, and we'll manage the broader workload. But if I don't know about the problem, that's a great way to get in real trouble. So again, I spoke to this, but this is just striking to me. You know, you go in the aftermath of something bad, somebody always knew something was wrong. And as that error chain of 10, 15, 20 things links together and the clock runs, you want people to raise their hands. If it doesn't feel right, it isn't right, right? It's a problem to prove an otherwise, not, oh, they must know what they're doing, this will work out. Okay. So let's look. This is four hospitals. Every one of these little lines is a clinical unit in a real hospital, and we're asking a basic question. In this clinical area, it's difficult to speak up if I perceive a problem with patient care. The answer should be zero, and again, there's some units here where it is zero, where it's pretty close, it's 90%. 9 out of 10 of these people are gonna raise their hand if something doesn't feel right. And those are exactly the people you wanna work with, and those are exactly the people you want to take care of your family. Well, then we get over here, which says 1 in 4 people say I would be hesitant to raise my hand. And then we get to here, where it's a coin toss, and then we get to what I affectionately call the North Korean model, where nobody's gonna raise their hand. Right? Or like, what are you kidding? Some cruel joke, right? So it isn't a lot of fun to be here, and it's frankly dangerous. And this is a key piece to work on. So Amy Edmondson, a lot of her work is available online as faculty working papers from the Harvard Business School. She wrote an exceptional book last year called Teaming, where she really put together 15 years of work. I've read all her articles, and I read her book, and I'm like, whoa, the book is good. And it really is the sense of, does feel safe to raise my hand. So one of the things Edmondson talks about are these kind of image protectors or micro behaviors. And we all have them, right? In our professional life, our personal life, we have an image, we dress in a certain way, we behave in a certain way, and we're pretty invested in it, right? Well, nobody wants to look stupid, and particularly in healthcare. I mean, in your hospital where you deliver care, when was the last time somebody raised their hand and said, I just want to announce to everybody, I have no idea what's going on here, right? You're like, let's vote them off the island. But I would strongly suspect, in the recent past, you stood there thinking, I hope they know what they're doing, because it's totally unclear to me, right? Right? I mean, I spent 20 years with surgeons. I'm like, you're going to do what, right? And when will we be doing that? And it'd be nice if we talked about that before. So this is very powerful. And if you don't want to look dumb, you don't speak up, right? You don't want to look incompetent, you don't ask for feedback or suggestions. I mean, these are very, very powerful modifiers of behavior. And that's why setting that tone is so key, is giving people permission to speak and asking them to do so. Again, because this is learning, this is effective teamwork. You ask questions, you ask for feedback. If your brain doesn't like something, there's usually a pretty good reason, because you saw it before somewhere and you didn't like it the last time. And you just have to say it's wrong to proven right. That's the assurance of safety rather than the assumption. And that's a very fundamental difference. So how do we get better at learning from mistakes? Right? And again, there is an accountability. You've got to be skilled in doing the right thing, playing by the rules, but you have to make it safe to learn. And I'll tell you, there's a lot of places in America, it depends who I'm working with. If I'm working with this manager, I'm comfortable telling her. There's a couple places like this, nothing good will come from talking about this, so we don't, right? And that doesn't fix the problem, right? It just festers. Here we have basically, it's systematic. We have a simple set of rules, we feedback, we take data. Let's take an example of Duke. It works at Duke. You know why it works at Duke? Because the CEO of Duke and the CNO of Duke went to all 80-some clinical units within that hospital and talked about real cases with frontline folks and says, this happened here, in some cases it happened right here. Let's talk about a serious episode of avoidable harm or death. Let's run it through the algorithm. So it's the boss saying, here are the rules. That's how it that's what you need to make it live and breathe. There are a lot of hospitals in this country have a just culture algorithm, and I can walk in and say, if you made a mistake here, what are the rules? And nobody can tell me. So again, this is an organization of multiple hospitals, very good organization, and we measured culture. And we asked a very simple question. In this work setting, it's difficult to discuss mistakes. These are all surgical service lines. The most expensive, dangerous place in the hospital. This is all the same hospital system. And there's a whole bunch of places where half or a third of the people in those operating rooms say, I would be hesitant to speak up about a mistake. Or if we make a mistake, we can't have an open, honest conversation to learn. That number needs to be zero, right? We owe it to ourselves and we owe it to our patients, frankly. So let's talk a little bit about human error. And I want to tell you, this is Sidney Decker's work. It comes from a book called The Field Guide to Human Error, which is an excellent book. And he has this kind of model of, here's the way we've all been trained. Here's the way we really need to think about it. This is kind of who did it, right? We're pretty good at that. Something bad happened, you know, who did it? And in fact, what he says is you really should ask, how was it possible? They didn't get out of bed to do it. That's a pretty rare event. So given you had smart, skilled people trying to do the right thing, how was it possible for them to end up somewhere they really did not want to end up? And, you know, you can sit in a room. I mean, clinical care is so complex. I mean, you look at error chains. We looked at a terrible obstetrical case in New York City. There were 34 links in the error chain before a bunch of very skilled obstetricians looked at a sinusoidal tracing, which is terrifying, and convinced themselves at 3 in the morning it was okay. It wasn't okay. The APGAR was 1, right? And so you can sit in a room and you can say, well, you know, here are the 11 places these knuckleheads, right, did the wrong thing. What you want to do is you want to say, what did they see? What did they understand? How did they think about this? Because they didn't get out of bed to do this. Now we can learn and keep it from happening again. Give you a simple example. I have a friend, Rick Martinez. He's a 777 training captain for United. And we were talking about it. He says, here's how it works in the flight world. So, you know, he flies long hauls across the Pacific, et cetera. And he says, you know, we're flying the 777, the co-pilot's flying, we're coming into the West Coast, and he's doing some things I wouldn't. But we're still within the envelope. We're safe. And he says, I just kind of watch it unfold, you know, as long as we're not putting, you know, shall we say, the plane at risk. And they'll pull up to the gate, set the brake, turn off the engines, and he says, I'll just turn to him and say, help me understand what you were thinking, right? Take me through what you saw, how you made these decisions that caused you to do what you did. That's called learning, right? And it's also a very effective way to learn, which is much better than, you know, you knucklehead, why did you do that? So the other thing that's important is we think complex systems are safe. Every step in a process can fail, because they generally involve human beings. So it's really important to simplify processes, right? And what we tend to do is when we make a mistake is we'll add a step. Oh, now we're going to do a double check on a medication. Well, the failure rate in a double check is about 25% because nobody's paying attention. They're running down the hall like, okay, Sue, did you see that, right? Because they don't see value in it, right? So making processes simple and transparent is key. You know, in aviation, tried this one in the 80s, which is humans make mistakes, let's computerize the flight deck. And then the leading cause of accidents became what? Automation, right? What does Southwest Airlines do? They use the minimal level of automation in the 737. You want multiple layers of people. I can give you great examples of housekeepers who have called physicians and said, you need to come up here, your patient's in trouble. And they were absolutely correct. Housekeepers, right? Everybody has a voice in the care of the patient. And if you give them that voice and you respect it, I mean, the person who kept me out of more trouble in 20 years in the operating room, his name's Glenn. He's the orderly at night. Because I could be there at 3 in the morning with somebody who's trying to die, and I'm tired, I'm busy, and I'm task fixated. And this voice many times came over my shoulder of, hey, Michael, what about this? And I'm like, whoa, thank you very much. Because he's standing back and he's seeing the broader picture, right? So everybody is important. So let's talk about this concept of drift. We can call it a migration of boundaries. Drift is another term. It's a complicated slide. We'll try and keep it simple. This is the expected safe space of action. Here's your policies and procedures. But yet, we're all drifting out here into the illegal normal. We're taking shortcuts. Any of you guys not have workarounds in your care? Okay, we're all in the club. Okay, because workarounds means you're working around the system because the system doesn't work, right? So why don't we redesign the system? So let's see if this applies to us. Because the more we migrate out here, the greatest the chance of something bad happening. And then you're in trouble. Here's your standard of care. You were doing this. Gotcha. So we're out on the interstate highway. It's a beautiful day. No state troopers in evidence. The speed limit is 60 miles an hour. Who in this room drives 60 miles an hour? Nobody. Okay, none of us, right? So what do you drive? 65, 68, 70, 75, 80. You all got a set of rules. I mean, immediately in your head, you added some number to 60, right? And most people are like 8 to 10, you know, not going to pull me over because that's the illegal normal, like everybody else is doing it, right? How did they blow up the Challenger space shuttle? How did they launch a space shuttle in 1986 that was never, ever, never designed to be launched below 55 degrees Fahrenheit? How did they launch it at launch 25 at 36 degrees covered with ice? 36 degrees. I mean, you look at the pictures of it. They had ice on the outside of the shuttle. Did they wake up one morning and say, forget the rule book, we'll go here? They slowly slid toward the edge of the cliff. 52, 51, 49, 47. Over 24 launches, they kept shaving the acceptable launch temperature. And then there was this big push, teacher in space, Reagan on the phone, Krista McAuliffe, canceled twice for cold weather, all this push, push, push to get it done. And they leaped into the 30s. Here's the sad part. There's many sad parts to that. Every time they launch these things, you know, the boosters, the fuel tanks fall in the ocean, they're retrieved, they analyze them. And again, you don't want to launch it cold because there's a little thing called an O-ring. It's a rubber seal between the booster and the main fuel tank. Rubber gets cold, rubber gets hard, leaks. You can look at graphs in Diane Vaughan's book on the Challenger launch decision that showed as the temperature was going down, they were getting progressive blow-by or leaking at the O-ring. It wasn't a big jump, it wasn't a big delta, but you have this nice line that says O-ring failure, O-ring failure, O-ring failure. Well, you know, we've always done it before, never blew up. So it's exactly the same behavior. How does that play in a hospital? I'll show you how it plays in a hospital. So these are cases of very simple things that actually seriously hurt or killed patients. This is a Nova hospital in Virginia. It's a very good hospital. 23-year-old woman is admitted to a Nova Fairfax for elective bowel surgery. She has inflammatory bowel disease. She's admitted to the hospital bed by the door. Her roommate leaves. She wants to move to the bed by the window to admire the view. Nurses say, sure, no problem, but they're so busy they forget to change it in the computer. They anticipate transfusing her. 5:30 in the morning. You want to talk about a lethal act of kindness? 5:30 in the morning, somebody comes up to draw a type and cross, does not want to disturb the other patient in the room, doesn't turn on the light, shakes the patient in the bed by the door, so you so-and-so, apparently hears something that sounds like yes, and draws a type and cross on the wrong patient, right? And they give her somebody else's blood in the operating room. The little stuff. It's not the big stuff. It's the little stuff. Here's a very good hospital, big academic medical center. Patient comes into the emergency department, happens to be a physician, has a rare metabolic disease, gets abdominal pain and fever, needs antibiotics and pain medicine. Nurse is going to go give it to the patient, gets immediately called for a trauma, says to her colleague, go give this in room 20. Goes in the room, starts to hang the antibiotic. The patient slash doctor says, what are you giving me? Oh, we're giving you semi-synthetic penicillin. Don't do that. I anaphylaxed to penicillin. I try and die, so let's not be doing that today. So the service recovery is, oh, I'm giving you your pain medicine as it's going through the IV. What are you giving me? Well, I'm giving you Dilaudid. I can't have Dilaudid. I stop breathing. Better go find somebody because I will stop breathing and does. It's always a bad day when the boss is on the ventilator in the ICU and you put him there, right? So that was not a happy moment. So when the patient safety officer goes to kind of investigate, she's talking to the nurse, and the nurse who's beside themselves keeps saying, I knew I was in room 20, room 20, room 20. What about the patient ID band? Well, what's the shortcut? The shortcut's using the room number. So they were actually pretty smart about this. And went and asked 10 other nurses, could you make this mistake? What do you think the answer was? Yeah, we do it in 5 seconds, because we're all doing it. That's the workaround. So that was actually a pretty good opportunity. Now think about it. You can do two things. One is you're going to hang the nurse out to dry, right? We're going to send a message, and you're just going to create more fear, right? Which is, if it happens to you, you're toast. So why would I tell anybody about anything? So which ensures we can do it again. But where they were actually quite smart, they got her job was to stand in a room in front of 100 people, her colleagues, and say, let me tell you what happened to me, so it won't happen to you. That's pretty effective. And then it was the role of leadership to say, we all been living out here, and from this moment forth, we're going back here, and don't ever cross that line. The tolerance will be zero. I think that's actually pretty effective leadership. So again, it's the simple stuff. Simple model. This is Jim Reason's model from the United Kingdom, the world expert on human error. Somebody makes a mistake, he asks 4 questions. Did they intend to hurt somebody? No. It's criminal behavior. They come to work drunk, that's also a bad idea. Did they do something? We would say, you consciously took on unacceptable risk. Transfusing a unit of blood, you say to me, we need to check the unit of blood. I say, I'm too busy, just give it. Bad idea, very bad idea. We never do that, okay? That's unacceptable conscious risk. And the simple test for that is, if I came to you and said, here's what I did, you go, that was a bad idea, right? That's conscious unsafe act. And then there's a substitution test. If I went and asked 2 or 3 people of similar skill and training, could they make the mistake in that circumstance? 95% of the time you ask these 4 questions, you end up with a good person trying hard, playing by the rules, set up to fail. And there will be no blame or shame to them, right? That is the model of accountability. And you have to be able, this is very similar to the aviation safety algorithm. And in fact, ASAP, open reporting within the airlines in this country, United Airlines every week in Denver gets 70 reports. And those aren't the bullets a foot from your head, those are the bullets about a mile away. But they get hundreds of thousands of reports, they can see the patterns, and that's why your chance of not walking off an airplane in this country is now 1 in 41 million. So teamwork. Again, this is kind of like, you know, we just go try hard. This is like, you know, we're playing offense, we go in the room, we brief, we think, what are we gonna need, who are we gonna need, when are we gonna need it, and we think ahead. That's what experts do, and you perform much, much better. What do teams do? It's pretty simple, right? You just gotta hardwire it. And you know, what's the challenge in medicine? Oh, we're too busy for that, right? I mean, I spent 20 years in the operating room, and they're like, oh, you know, we're gonna do this complex thoracic case, and well, it's on the schedule, right? It says left thoracotomy, right? Well, it's on my card, my surgical card that's in 14 different colors because I change it every time I'm in the room. You need the narrative. What are we doing? Why are we thinking about this? What's plan A, plan B? Every good physician with a difficult patient is already mentally simulated. What am I going to do, and what are the contingencies? And so if we can plan forward, then this is a piece where we have huge opportunity, in particular on the civilian side in this country, which is we just did it. What did we do well? What did we learn? What are we going to fix? You can do that in 60 seconds. And in our version of debrief is something terrible happened, we're going to spend an hour in a room. No, you do it when it's fresh in your mind. Be structured. Use things like SBAR that came from the nuclear Navy. My friend Doug Bonicum used to be a weapons control officer. And then this whole concept of critical language. Do we have one word? Do you have one word in your hospital that if anybody says it, says, please stop and talk to me, let's make sure we're doing the right thing? Here's a great word. It's called, I just need a little clarity. It comes from a line of hospitals in Minnesota. Anybody ask for clarity anywhere, anytime, you can do it in front of a patient and their family. Nobody's gonna lose their mind. just says, we're going to stop and talk. We're going to take 1 minute to ensure we're in the right movie. We're doing the right thing. You know, what does aviation use? They use cuss. I'm concerned. I'm uncomfortable. This is unsafe. I'm scared. You know, we're not going to say, I'm scared. Patients, you're scared. I'm terrified, right? So that's probably not an effective. So these things are pretty key. Readbacks. I mean, you go to Starbucks, you get a readback. You order Chinese food in America, you get a readback. Or at room service last night, you get a readback, right? But you can get on the phone and order some amazing doses of medication in American Hospital, and they're like, okay, you must know what they're doing, right? I mean, we had a patient in our emergency department 8 years ago. We were on paper, the patient came with itching and a rash, physician wanted to get 50 milligrams of IV Benadryl, and accidentally wrote 500. And a traveling nurse drew up 10 vials of Benadryl into a 10 ml syringe and gave 500 milligrams IV. Good news? No itching. That was the end of the good news, right? I was unconscious for like 3 days, right? It's like, believe me, if it can be done, we've done it. So critical language, we talked about, this is key, right? It's fresh in our brain, you validate the work. What did we learn? So we'll do it better the next time. And what got in the way? So here are some clinical units that debrief. This is an ICU collaborative in the state of Rhode Island, working on standard stuff, ventilator-associated pneumonia, central line infection, safety culture. This is the whole state, 23 units, safety culture. Year 1, 2, 3, 4, no change. Year 5, 9 out of 23 units started debriefing their data, looking in the mirror, what are the one or two simple things we're going to do. Look what happened to the culture. The other thing is, look what happened to bloodstream infection and ventilator-associated pneumonia. One is doing 4 things, one is doing 5 things. That's the difference between checking the box and intentional work. Pretty simple. Process improvement. We're not very good at this in healthcare. We're good at trying hard. So here's a simple model, and many of the things I actually should attribute. Many of the structures in this come from a program called TEM, or team-based engagement, that we've had the privilege of working with our friends at Mayo with, who co-developed, and probably should have said that sooner. So every unit you walk into, you'd like to see 2 things. You'd like to see a process board, here are the things we care about that we're doing. You'd like to see a learning board. Here's what they look like. Here's a hospital in Scotland, 1,100-bed hospital in Dundee. They admit this is a medicine admissions unit. They have 11 measures on the wall. Blood culture contamination, last month it was 3%, the goal is 2%. It's not big and complicated, it's not like the multi-dashboard, can't get your brain around. It's really, here are the 8 or 10 things we care about, here's where we are, here's where we want to be, right? Visible, every time I walk in there. Here's a learning board. This is a hospital, this is a Catholic Health Partners hospital in Ohio. So we're in the operating room, you debrief, what got in the way, the C-arm was unavailable, whatever, the equipment didn't work. It goes on the red board. They call it a turtle board because they're actually next to a lake, and it's hard to see up here, but there's, you turtle a sailboat, you capsize it, here it's riding, here you're sailing off in the sunset. But it's like a stoplight. This got in the way, this didn't work, goes on the red board. The only thing that doesn't go on the red board is interpersonal stuff, right? This is stuff we're working to fix. So in order to move from here, and do not underestimate the power of, I told you, you listened, I can see it. Because at most hospitals in this country, I tell you, you listen, and it disappears and I never hear again, which means you don't care, or my problem didn't get fixed. So in order to move from red to yellow, somebody's name is on it. Who's going to fix it? When is that going to happen? How are we going to know? And what was interesting in this hospital, initially they had to assign people because nobody actually believed they were serious about it. Oh, it's the flavor of the month, we'll do this project. And it's like, no, we're serious. We're going to do this. So once the staff realized people were serious, they started to volunteer. So here's the problem, here's the ones we're fixing, here's the ones we have fixed. You can walk into this unit and they say, we have identified 117 problems, fixed 43%, 41 in progress, only 11%. This is closing that loop of learning. It's absolutely critical. So let me stop there. I wanted to save a minute or two for questions, and my time management was not optimal, but at least I didn't get on orthopedic time, right? I'm known to do that on occasion.
I need clarity.
You need clarity? We should probably move along, or?
A couple of questions.
Okay.
If there are any
questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Let you come out of the anesthetic that I've administered to you for the last 55 minutes, which I'm fully capable of, believe me. Please. Yeah, I think it's a great question. So what's the role of information technology? I think technology, if thought through well, can be a huge enabler. I think one of the fundamental problems we have with electronic medical records is they were fundamentally designed for billing and code capture. They were not designed for actual patient care. I spent 10 years in Kaiser buying medical equipment. We bought a lot of stuff of patient monitors, anesthesia machines, et cetera. When we sat with people like Hewlett-Packard in alpha and beta development and said, here's what we need it to look like, here's how we think, here's what I need on that display in order to navigate this, we got great equipment. And they sold a lot of stuff. So I think technology, it's coming, it's here. And I think it has huge potential as long as we're very smart about the development of the technology with the people who are actually doing the work. Okay, and I would also say Dr. Paulus over here has deep expertise in that area, so he can probably offer an opinion as well. He'll offer an opinion later. Yeah. Other thoughts, or shall we move along here? Yeah, your question is a critical one because let me just speak to the IT piece again. What you don't want to do is go into a hospital and say to the doctors, I'll allow you to do everything in the computer you did on paper, because you just generate so much noise you can't see it, right? And you know, then we're in the piece where you have a lot of systems that are legacy that don't talk to each other. And we still have situations where you have electronic medical records and people are still having to go into subscreens. You want all the information. You know, you want coherence. You want it to, and you want to be able to follow the patient over time. I mean, our risk, both in clinical care and deriving information, is you want to see the trajectory, the patient's journey over time. You don't want to just see one data point, right, because you don't have the context for that. Anyway, thank you for the privilege of spending some time with you. I'll be around all day.